it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And the flood came and destroyed them all. So in Jesus' explanation, there was nothing peculiar about Sodom and Gomorrah as different from what happened in the days of Noah. That is, what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah is the same thing that happened to the days of Noah. And is the same thing that will happen in the days of the Son of Man. There was nothing peculiar about Sodom and Gomorrah. The same problem that Sodom and Gomorrah had is the same problem that the days of Noah had. And it will be the same problem that our days will have, which means the sin will be consistent. The sin that befell the days of Noah befell the days of Sodom and Gomorrah and will befall this generation, which will be what? Unbelief. Which will be unbelief. What is unbelief? The absence and rejection of what was given. What was given? The gospel. When you refuse the gospel and reject the gospel, then you have admitted destruction. Because when you reject the gospel, God withdraws his presence. When God withdraws his presence, the resultant effect of the absence of God's presence is destruction. Sin is judged after faith is rejected. Jesus never singled out anybody's sin. Jesus never singled out anybody's sin. What Jesus singled out was unbelief. What Jesus singled out was unbelief. So if Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed, it's the same thing that they did that happened in the days of Noah. Unbelief, not homosexuality. But homosexuality is a sin. It is called sexual immorality. Homosexuality is a sin, just like fornication and adultery and lasciviousness. They are all sins in the same class. Jesus doesn't single out individual sins. In John chapter 8, a woman was brought to him who was caught in adultery, caught in the very act. He did not condemn her, neither did he approve of her. He did not condemn her, neither did he approve of her. He simply gave her the gift of acceptance and told her, go and sin no more. He didn't reject her. He didn't approve of her. He received her and showed her what to do. He never singles out individual sins. He saw a harlot. He allowed her to come near him. He allowed her to hold him. He allowed her to kiss him. He allowed her to perfume his body. He didn't stop her. He accepted her the way she was. This is God himself, not your G.O. I'm talking about God Almighty, Daddy God, not Daddy G.O. He allowed the woman to kiss his legs. He allowed the woman to sob on his feet. He allowed her access. He didn't say, dirty thing, stop me. No. He welcomed her to himself, because sin cannot defile God. Rather, God will destroy sin. He gave her the gift of acceptance. Hallelujah. He never singled out her sin. He said to her, your sins are forgiven. Glory to God. These are two sins of sexual immorality. Two sins of sexual immorality. The woman caught in the act and the prostitute. Another woman had five husbands. Glory to God. How many husbands? The other day people were tearing their trousers over man marrying two wives. This one is five. Deal with that. Jesus met her and didn't talk about the five husbands. He talked about the salvation of her soul. They say you have five husbands. The one you're even with is not your husband. This must be the Messiah. That was it. From there she became an evangelist. He didn't tell her, go and divorce your five men first before you can preach. She went to preach with her five husbands. He never singles out individual sins, because sin is sin. In fact, honey, you know what Jesus said to her? If you knew who I am, you would have asked. In her condition with five husbands, she will ask and he will answer. You're not hearing me. That is in her state with her five men. In her immoral life, she can pray and God will answer. He said, if you knew what, you will have asked and I will have given you living water. You're not seeing what I'm showing you. You will have asked and I will have given you living water. And you will never thirst again. She said, are you greater than our fathers? He said, you have five husbands. One. She said, this man must be the Messiah. Come and see one man. He must be the Messiah. Faith in Christ. Faith in Christ. Jesus didn't say, mention their names one by one quickly. and tell us which ones you're going to send away quickly before we... Now, he does not single out individual sins. Homosexuality is a sin. Don't be scared of it. Somebody says I'm a homosexual. I say, aye, blood of Jesus, stand there. No. It's a sin like every other sin. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Underline that. To dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Next verse. Who changed the truth of God into a lie? They changed the truth of God. A man goes to hospital, removes his organ as a man, and wears a woman's organ. Who changed the truth of God into a lie? And worship and serve the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Did you see that? A man looking for another man to sleep with. In a world of so many women that humorously within the week, I even heard there's a nation where their president said every man should marry two wives because the women are too much. So in a world of so many women, a man chasing man, bro. Some of them say that's how I was born. That's a lie. You're changing the truth of God into a lie. Nobody was born like that. You're just suffering from identity crisis. You don't know yourself. You're lost. And you can never know yourself till you know Christ. So the homosexual man, the lying man, and those who are not in such habits, all of them require faith in Christ to be saved. The homosexual, the liar, and those that don't have those habitual bondages, both they and they require faith in Christ to be saved. So man with man is a sin, not a sin in a special book of the Bible. Not a sin in a special book of the Bible. To say I'm a homosexual is like saying I'm a prostitute. It's like saying I'm a fornicator. It's like saying I'm a liar. It's the same thing. Can a Christian have a homosexual habit? Yes, in capital letters. So how can somebody imagine that God destroys homosexuals? God does not destroy anybody. People choose destruction when they reject God's salvation. You didn't hear what I said. People choose destruction when they reject God's salvation. God saves the homosexuals, just like he saves the fearful, just like he saves the backbiters, just like he saves people with strife and anger and all sins. It's like somebody says, I have anger issues, I am working on it. It's the same thing. He has homosexual issue, he is also working on it. It's the same thing. I have anger issues. I know I am saved. I know I am born again. I am working on it. Yes, the homosexual has homosexual issues. He's born again. He is saved. He is working on it. So what do you do to the homosexual? Put him on the mirror. Let him see Christ. As he begins to look into that perfect law of liberty, we all with open face, beholding the glory of God as in a mirror, we are changed into that same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. When people look at the mirror, the change takes place. People are not changed by condemnation. People are changed by righteousness. Awake to righteousness and sin not. People are not changed by pointing them to their sin. People are changed by pointing them to the truth. All I do is show you the truth. When I give you the truth, I leave you with the truth. The truth will do what it is best in doing. And what does the truth do? It sets free. We preach the truth. We preach the message of Christ. We lead people with Jesus. He knows what to do with them. You may reject the prostitute, but Jesus accepts her to kiss his legs. You can't deal with it, but Jesus has dealt with it. You can't handle it. Hey, brother, get out of the way. You are not the savior of the world. Jesus will take care of the matter. Let Jesus do what only he can do in people's life. Stop being the registrar of heaven and stop being the secretary of heaven. Give way, my friend. You cannot save a fly. Let Jesus do what he alone can do. Leave the man with Jesus. Two of them will sort themselves out. Am I talking to somebody here? Mendo Labayata. Stop looking for people's shortcomings. You too, you have your own. Concentrate on your own and solve your own. Jesus knows what to do with them. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Zigadagabayada. Zigagabadagaya. Did I solve the issue of homosexuality? Even the issue of transgender is identity crisis. How can a man just wake up and say, I'm a woman? I'm not a man. And he goes to hospital and pays expensively for him to be operated on. It's identity crisis. The question is, if such people are saved and they go and change their organ, will they be in heaven? Yes. They will be in heaven, but they will have earthly shortages. They will have what? Earthly shortages. Glory to God. They are suffering from identity. The greatest problem of mankind is identity crisis. That is why the solution to man's problem is the revelation of Jesus. When you see Jesus, in Jesus you see yourself. Once you see yourself, crisis ends. Oh, like never before, that's our mandate, to reintroduce Jesus to this generation. Equipping the believer to know who you are in Christ, what you have in Christ, and what Christ can do through you. That's what we're about as a church. And I declare unto you, you will proclaim this gospel. You will preach this good news. You will preach it on the mountaintop. You will preach it on the housetop. You will preach it in the villages. You will preach it in the cities. You will preach it in your office. You will make Jesus known to your generation. In the name of Jesus.